Welcome to another episode of the Startup Operator Podcast. I'm your host, Roshan Karyappa. Our guest today is Harpreet Grover. He's an active angel investor and the co-founder and former CEO of CoCubes, an HR tech company that was acquired by Aon Hewitt. I'm going to be talking to him about his book, Let's Build a Company, a startup story minus the bullshit. It's a great read, offers very practical insights on business building and as well, it's very intensely honest. This episode is brought to you by Moolia. You want to move fast? Sure. But without breaking things? Now that's a hard ask. The thing is, once you have some base of users and customers, you just cannot afford to risk quality. So how do the likes of Cred, Swiggy and CureFit, you know, some of India's fastest growing startups, ship at lightning pace and delight their users and customers? Simple, they're working with Moolia as a strategic quality partner. Moolia is India's most talented and passionate community of testers. They've helped prevent thousands of bugs and regression issues. So as a CTO or a product owner, if you want to reduce tech debt, especially while you scale, do check out Moolia.com. I've interviewed Moolia's founder and CEO Pradeep on the podcast earlier, and we spoke about how startups can improve quality while scaling and things to that effect. You should definitely check it out. I'll link to it in the description below. Welcome to the podcast, Harpreet. Thank you so much for making the time.
Hey, thank you, Roshan. Excited. Look forward to chatting with you. And hello to everyone who's listening.
So, Harpreet, let's begin with this journey, right? What's this journey been like the past few days as an author?
As an author? I think the journey has been weird. I'm saying we launched the book on TechSparks at Your Story. Right. I launched the book and I come out of the place. I get a call from my home that my father has tested positive for COVID. Wow. Okay. So the next morning I'm flying out to Chandigarh. You know, my father is doing well now. He's at home. He's chilled out. You know, yeah. Mom wants him to come out of quarantine. He's saying, I'm very happy in quarantine. So, you know, but essentially it was a weird mix. You know, the book was doing well. Right. But, you know, actually I was in hospitals and running around. So, you know, standing outside and looking at LinkedIn and Twitter and stuff like this. So actually very different from, you know, the answer that you might have imagined, but it was interesting. Yeah. But the good part is I remember how, I remember telling Anish, who's our agent, saying, yaar, ye kitab itni acche se likhi nahi hui. You know, I'm not sure if we should do it or not. You know, it was about 2-4 months ago. And he said, yaar, ab tumne likh di hai, don't worry about it so much. You know, in the sense of now that it is out and we are getting good feedback from everybody, it seems very easy. But, you know, till the time people read it, you don't really know. Kyunki pehle to dosti aapko feedback de rahe hote hai na. So, no, you don't really know whether it is good or not. I'm just trying to make you happy.
Right.
So it's been interesting.
Right. No, I think one of the things that I really appreciated about the book is that it's so honest about things. You know, I mean, you talk about your mistakes more than your successes, which is very unusual in the usual startup book as such, right? Because I don't know what happens to founders when they look back. You know, everything sort of seems like a stroke of genius to most people. But while you are in that journey, I mean, it's anything but that, right? But you've done a very good job of sort of documenting those stumbles and those frustrations and so on and so forth, right? So let's begin with the title itself, you know, a startup story minus the bullshit. So what is this bullshit that you reference to?
Yeah, I think you've said it yourself, you know, that many startup books or many stories come out as hero stories.
Right.
You know, and I think, yes, the journey is very hard. If you come out successful, you know, maybe you can treat yourself like a hero. Maybe others treat you like a hero. But in general, I think when you get popular, ego also takes over. And it's very hard to talk about what went wrong. Yeah, because, you know, you don't really want to talk about it. You want to talk about what you did right. And I remember being in 2006, 2007. And when we were just out of college, 23, 24 years old, you know, there was very, very few entrepreneurs who were out there, and nobody had built a large company, or there was no entrepreneurship ecosystem. So we didn't have people to look up to and say, okay, what mistakes to make, what mistakes to not make. And we learned everything, stumbled. And I think if we knew what we know now, we could have built a larger company. We could have built a different company. So many things that we would have done differently because we are wiser. And you know, like when you're a parent and you know, and some of you listening might actually have kids. I have a 5-year-old daughter. When you're a first time parent, you learn everything. You know, so similarly, when you open a company, you learn everything from scratch. You go through the same learning. Everybody does the same. So we thought, can we put our learnings together in the same place? And, you know, actually the book likhni thi, what actually happened was that somebody said, write a book. And I said, there's no point in writing a book. We haven't built a $1 billion company. Right. And the person said, okay, the reason I wanted to write a book is because you worked hard 10 years and you had a good exit. So most people won't build a $1 billion company, you know, but people can read a book and believe that if you work hard, you can get a good outcome for yourself, for your team members, for your investors, for everybody. Right. So, you know, that is how we ended up writing the book. And that's what we meant by having no bullshit in the book.
Right. And the book is also written in two parts, right? Which is, again, something pretty interesting that I thought, you know, the first part talks about the CoCube story, you know, from founding to exit. And then the second part is on your reflections and on your learnings as such, right? Why did you decide to write the book in that fashion?
I think the mind is funny, because let me first say to you that looking back, I could say the reason the book is written is because people don't know the story of CoCubes. If I was writing the story of Flipkart, let's say, I don't need to tell the story of Flipkart. I can straight away, you know, go to the second part and only talk about the first part. Yeah. But people don't know the story of CoCubes. It's not as famous, as popular. And hence, this is in two parts. And what is the story? And then what are the learnings, right? And what is the impact on individuals? Now, this is the mind playing tricks, because the mind tells me that I thought of it in this manner and I'm very smart. But actually, what happened was I started writing the book. I did not write the book in series. You know, the book was written as saying whatever I remembered, I started writing. You know, sometimes it was learning. Sometimes it was a story. When it all combined together, it was not fitting. So the only way it was fitting is part one and part two. But I think it has come out well that way. At least I like it.
Yeah. No, I mean, the format makes a lot of sense, because part one really sets the context for part two. Because I mean, as you rightly mentioned, I think trying to get both of these across combined would have been a bit of a challenge, I feel. Right. So one of the things that you talk about as a learning is picking a market, right? And you know, now you're an angel investor. You must have founders pitching to you on a daily basis. What is the advice that you give to founders on picking a market, on, you know, how it's important to first know what you're building for and where you're building?
So I think we see this more in younger entrepreneurs, right? Where essentially younger entrepreneurs generally start a company either because it is in a hot space, right? Or it is a problem that they ended up encountering. Now, that is a great place to start. But what is important is that when you are raising capital, or if you want to build a company where you want to build a very large company, or you want to raise capital, you need to be cognizant of what is the market size. And what might be big for you might not be big for a venture capitalist, right? For example, if you are starting a company and you're okay with the company making 100 crores in revenue in 6, 7, 8 years, that is great. But it is of no interest to a venture capital guy, or of very low interest to a venture capital guy, because for them, you know, they want to see a $1 billion company in every company that they fund. This is something that, you know, first time founders don't understand. They think I'm pitching my idea and, you know, it is a great idea. They can see how it will get to 10, 20, 30, 40, 50 crores or a few million dollars in revenue. But the VC just has very different eyes of looking at it. And the problem often, you know, lies in the market size that they're looking at. And hence it is important to be cognizant, do a very detailed check. For example, I remember this was brought home to me by Dhruv Agarwal. Actually, Dhruv just sold a large portion of his company, Prop Tiger, was bought by somebody else. So he also got an exit right now. But I remember going out, he invited me to lunch, Karthik and Dhruv. They were founders of iTrust back then. And, you know, we were having lunch and, you know, they said, Acha, you know, what are you doing with CoCubes? You know, how much are you going to charge per campus? I said, we're going to charge 3,000 rupees per college. And they said, yeah, per India, mein toh 30,000 colleges hi hain. So how much can you earn, right? Your market size is only 10 crores. So why will somebody invest in you? That was the first time as a young entrepreneur, you know, I thought, dude, this company can't be large enough. The mistake we made is, I think we got married to CoCubes as a name. that CoQs meant connecting colleges and companies, CO cross CO cross CO. And it meant so much to us that we spent 10 years around the problem. And when we understood that we could change, you know, it was too late. We were too tired and it was just 10 years, you know. And I'm very happy with what we have built. We've got a great outcome. We made a cash exit. Everybody made money. But I'm just saying, if I was to start it again, I could actually change. I could do a big pivot, which most entrepreneurs are unable to do.
Right. No, I mean, also this was, it's important to note that this was 2007, 2008, right? I mean, it was pre-Ola, pre-Flipkart, pre any kind of an ecosystem knowledge as such, as you rightly mentioned, right? So
yeah.
I'm not sure if, you know, some of these things could have been preempted at that point of time. One of the other aspects that you talk about is how founders are often naive about dealing with investors, right? They don't understand particularly that, you know, the investors themselves are running a business, right? That they need to sort of see things from an investor perspective as well. Because for a founder, I mean, his or her startup is, you know, the be all and end all, right? So what are some do's and don'ts in your opinion of, you know, raising money and so on?
I'm saying first decision you need to make is, do you need to raise money or not? What kind of business do you want to build? Right? Do you want to build a business which can be VC backed or not? Now, this is a hard choice. Because there are two places. One is you want to build a business and you don't want to raise capital, right? Ki mujhe business aise hi banana hai, right? The other is I want to build a large business. I want to raise capital, right? If you are in the second one, then you need to be sure that you are in a large enough market. That is critical. A lot of times you say, we don't know usko kaise paise mil gaya. Meri metrics better hai. You know, I have better metrics. I have better traction. But even if you have great traction and you are in a small market, you know, you are of very less interest to a venture capitalist. The other mistake people made is if you have gone to, you know, the standard advice is keep pitching to VCs, out of 100, only one has to say yes. That is true. You know, you only need one yes. But if you keep pitching without learning, actually nobody's going to end up saying yes. And this VC circle is a very tight-knit VC circle. If you have gone to five VCs, you can be rest assured everybody knows you're looking to raise money. Right? So go to 2-3 VCs, see what they are saying. See if traction is coming or not. If it's not coming, understand why it is not coming. And maybe, you know, try again 2 months down the line with feedback. Yeah. Maybe you're going to the wrong VCs. Maybe you need to go to a seed VC, which can invest $100,000, you know, but you're going to VCs who invest only 5 million. So these are some of the, you know, basic things that somebody can do. The other thing that I've seen founders do is they want to raise money from, let's say, Sequoia. So they will do their first pitch to Sequoia. That's a bad idea. You know, why don't you do your pitch to some other VCs and then you go to Sequoia once you've improved your pitch? Yeah. So I think there are some practical things that we learned, you know, while we were raising capital.
Right.
And there are some mistakes that entrepreneurs make.
Right. And on that note, how important are, you know, is that breed of founders who've seen an exit like yourself who are now putting money back in the ecosystem? You know, I mean, if you had this sort of a breed of entrepreneurs, who had turned investors at that point of time, would it, you know, what are some of the things that you can bring to the table to a founder right now at this point?
I think it is incorrect. For example, after the book has released, I think I've got a team number of requests on LinkedIn and Twitter, right? So one of the things is, you know, I'm thinking that I want to raise some capital from you. Or people are saying, you know, I am running this company. What advice would you have for me? VCs are not investing. I've tried pitching. And I'm saying, forget VCs. If you're building a company in SaaS, try getting the time of a founder who has already built a company in SaaS. And if you're building a company in SaaS, why won't you talk to Deepak Divakar of Mindtickle? You need to get his time. You know, he has built a company which is now worth $500 million, you know, and he loves helping entrepreneurs in general. So find a way for him to give you some advice in the SaaS category, rather than, you know, going to VC then, as a first stop, or right. Do both, right? But I think an entrepreneur who has built a company has so many practical nuggets to share that I think it is extremely helpful.
Right. Yeah. I mean, you may not have to go to an institutional investor to begin with. You could, you know, validate your idea, validate so many of these things with the, you know, a founder, as you said, right? So one of the things I really appreciate about the book also is the people aspect, right? And it's, I think it's, you've been through quite a roller coaster in that CoCubes journey, right? Growing to 120 plus and then downsizing again to a 60 and then growing back up all the way through your exit. What was that like? You know, I mean, I've been in a position where I've had to have the difficult conversation with people, and I can tell you it's like, it's one of the most difficult things to let go of people because of, let's say, company performance and so on, right? Because of no fault of either of them, either you or them, right? So what is that like? What was that journey like?
Yeah, I think it is very hard. Very, very hard, like you also said it, right? You feel like shit at that point in time. You have sold a dream to a person. Somebody came to you for a job, or you approached them and showed them dreams. You asked them to come and join you, right? In our case, we had acquired a company also, and we had told them we will give you money in so and so tranches. And then you have to go back and tell them, sorry, we don't have a job for you. Sorry, we were wrong. You know, you have written a letter to parents of all the team members saying your guy is doing well, you know, we are doing well. And then, you know, 8 months down the line, you have to go back and say, sorry, we have to let your son go or daughter go. So I think you feel like shit at that point in time. Even for us, I think we, you know, I've given this advice of firing early if you're running out of cash, or in general, maybe 20 entrepreneurs who have been in this situation. I think one guy has followed it. 19 others haven't followed it. In out of 19, 18 cases, the company has shut down because you run out of cash. We also almost ran out of cash. We actually delayed our firing by 3 months. If we had not delayed it by 3 months, we wouldn't have had to take debt, which was one big reason for us to go profitability route rather than a $1 billion company route, right? But we did actually ended up firing. And we were able to save the company, you know. And like I said, when you are firing, you feel like shit. But I'm saying, if you are the founder of the company, if the CEO of the company, your responsibility is to the company first. If you actually don't fire, the entire 120 people are going to lose their jobs, right? So, and what doesn't work is giving everybody 50% salary. You know, what works is giving, you know, half the people full salary and letting others go. So yeah, it's very hard. But, you know, the responsibility of the founder, as the CEO, is to get the company to survive. Everything else has to take seat. You have to take the hard pill. You have to make all the right choices, do the hard talks.
Right. I want to pick up on something that you mentioned just now, which is that you said that, you speak to the family of all your employees and people and whatnot, right? In fact, I mean, you don't use the word employees in the book. I mean, you call them people for the most part, right? So, how important is that, you think, for a founder to, you know, be in touch with your people's families and so on and so forth?
Look, I think I think the term we like to use for people is team members, right?
Team members. Okay, yeah.
Essentially, whenever we were talking to everybody, we would say, look, Vibhor and I are also team members. We are not saying we're going to run CoCubes for 100 years. This is going to be the only company we'll run. We are team members. We just have more equity than you. You can also get more equity. Right? That is the difference between us. It's not that we are founders and somebody else is an employee. We're all team members. We're working together. We have to build this company together. That was one of the, you know, tenets that we worked on. Now, knowing the family, is it important? I'm saying, can the company be built without knowing the family? Can very easily be built without knowing the family, right? But I think Indian culture is different. You know, in a US company, maybe you will never hear this. An Indian culture is different. Bhavesh actually has been from Ola has been very vocal about saying we need to go back to our Indian ethos. You know, we mimic US European companies too much. Our Indian ethos says we live as a community, right? That means we know each other. In India, if somebody has to join a job, they will still ask their parents. Maybe I don't think it happens in US. You know, if a company is going through a hard time, you know, if the parents put pressure saying chhodo to beta kuch aur dhoond lo, then the person will leave. The parents say, nahi, this company has treated you well. Why don't you stay with the company and see this through? They will stay with the company. So it is as important as that, because in our culture, everything goes together. You know, it's a potpourri. So I think in that context, it's a wise choice, but it's an investment of time. You know, some people don't have that mindset, and that's okay. You can build a company without that as well. We found building a company in that fashion to be very enjoyable.
Right. Yeah. And, you know, considering also that, you know, the startup life, whether you're a founder or an operator, it imposes such a personal cost, right? I mean, it usually comes at the cost of time with your family and so on. So it also makes sense to, you know, look at it that way, I feel, the way you and Vibhor sort of looked at it, right? One of the things I also appreciate about the book, as I've often mentioned, is the fact that it's honest. You're also honest about the personal cost as well, right? The cost to an entrepreneur's personal life as well. You want to talk about that? I mean, how, you know, you have to balance both your personal life and your startup life as an entrepreneur?
Look, I think there are stages of startup when you can't balance, when there is so much work to do, you can't do a balance. And if you try doing a balance, it just might not work, right? But I'm saying it is important to be cognizant of it at all times. If you're not cognizant and take your partner or other people for granted, it can have consequences. And this is the consequence that people don't talk about, right? In India, for a long time, women did not have financial freedom, and hence they continue to live together as husband and wives. But now this doesn't work that way, right? Women are more independent. Most founders have done love marriages. And I'm saying, if your first love is your company, you know, then your other love ends up suffering. And that is true. But actually, I've never heard anybody talking about it. Actually, to tell you, I'm saying this is the biggest input I've seen coming on LinkedIn, WhatsApp messages, Twitter, saying, thank you for talking about it.
Yeah.
We are going through a similar phase. Mm-hmm. Or we have gone through a similar phase. And it is very, very hard. Mm-hmm. You know, how do you explain it? Because you think, at that point in time, you think, main hi hu mere saath jo aisa ho raha hai. Baaki sab to theek hi lag rahe hain. You know, whereas that is not the case. Everybody goes through this. Mm-hmm. At this time, you know, going back, if I was to think, I would say, you know, you have to understand that you're not the only one going through this problem. And this is a problem which has a solution. You know, mm-hmm. talk to somebody who has gone through the same thing and find a solution. And the other thing I can guarantee is, definitely, if you take out 2 hours when you get home and forget your work and be with, you know, the family, your work won't suffer, right? You will still be able to build a company. There is no doubt about that in my head.
Right. Yeah. And, you know, one of the things when I talk to founders as well, is you know, I mean, if you're going to do this for any reasonable amount of time, it's going to be 10 years plus, right?
Yeah.
And you can't be killing yourself on a daily basis. I mean, it's almost like accumulating tech debt. You know, you can't Correct. Run with this for so long yeah. that it, yeah, it weighs you down. Exactly.
But right. Family debt, yeah?
Yeah.
Yeah, you keep accumulating it and sometimes, you know, the roof will fall.
Yeah, absolutely. You spend quite a bit of the book, especially in the second half, talking about culture, right? And something that you're deeply passionate about also, building a winning culture. And we'll talk about it in two different parts. So one is defining that culture. Second is sort of nurturing, enforcing that culture, right? Now, the first part, in your opinion, why do you think very few founders or, you know, I'm not even talking about very early stage companies, even like, let's say growth stage companies don't spend as much time defining that culture. What is it that they stand for?
I think time hota hi nahi hai yaar. You know, you don't have the time, you know, you're anyways overloaded. In India, startups are also hard because most startups are not only product, they are product plus services, they are operational. Actually, the only startups, if you see, which have been able to fend off attacks from the US larger companies are startups which have survived, are startups which had operations. You know, look at Flipkart, look at Ola, all these startups had services, and building services and product together in India is genuinely hard. So generally you don't have time. Yeah. And you're very passionate. You want to get work done. And you say, well, mujhe to kaam karwana hai, right? But I'm saying, like, you use the term tech debt, I think you can also take the term culture debt. You know, you keep accumulating it. The other thing that happens is, because I think in most such startups, the founder goes and says, I want to raise $20 million. The investor over the last 10 years, 7 years has been saying, forget 20, take 100. Now, if a founder then gets 100, they want to hire a lot. They want to expand a lot. And the thing is, hiring dilutes culture. And I think there's something that I was able to put in words when I wrote the book, but I did not fundamentally understand it in this manner when we were building the company, that hiring dilutes culture, right? That hiring is a bad thing for your culture, because the new people who come don't know how to behave. What is culture? Culture is, you know, being able to trust your colleague on certain common values. Trust the behavior of your colleague on certain common values. You know, when this gets repeated and repeated, this becomes your culture. So every company has a culture, no matter what. The question is, as a founder, do you want to define it or not? We don't end up defining it because there are 100 other priorities. There's a new product to launch, other things to do. You know, we treat our HR or recruitment folks as operations folks. And also, you know, like this lack of talent in HR and recruitment, right? So we treat them as normal folks who have to distribute letters and ensure salaries are paid on time. And we don't focus on culture, right? We don't lay down, these are the six values that we need to do, and we will stick by it. The other problem that occurs is, even if you lay it down, it is very hard to follow. You know, Amazon says every day is day one. Today is day one. Easy to say, so hard to do. And Amazon has been doing it for the last 20, 22, 23 years. But how many founders can actually say it and then mean it and ensure it is followed across the company at all points in time? But, you know, the fundamental thing that every founder needs to understand is that every person spends 8, 10 hours working. There are 200 working days. That means 2,000 hours of a person are spent. If you have 100 people in your company, that's 200,000 hours. If you want them to be utilized well, then the people need to know how they can behave. Like, you know, Ben Horowitz says that in good organizations, people can focus on their work and have confidence that if they get their work done, good things will happen to them and will happen to their company. I think the founders need to ask them, is this line valid for their company or not? And I think that is critical. In many companies, we are able to define what the, even the goal is. We are able to define how will we get there. We are able to define what we need from every team member to be able to get there. But we fail to define for the team member, what will they make if the company gets there?
Great point.
So, and until you define the end outcome for the person in question, you know, it doesn't really matter. Khali motivation pe nahi chal sakti company.
Right. Yeah, I mean, that's a great point that you bring up, right? Because, you know, you can expect people to be passionate and everything, but at some very deep fundamental level, their personal ambition has to overlap with the company aspiration, you know, otherwise it really won't sort of amplify their efforts and your ambitions as well. I mean, your momentum as a company as well. When should a founder prioritize, you know, defining this culture, and how are some ways, you know, they can sort of drive that culture down to the last person they hire?
I think the first thing you need to do is write down your common values. You know, so rather than going into, you could do a 3-day seminar or a webinar on culture, but, you know, write down your common values, you know, talk and see that you believe in them. Talk to people in the company that this is what we do, and then ensure they are followed every day. This is as simple as that. If you can do this, and this is a day's job or a week's job to do, then you are set for a long, long time. You can keep revisiting. You can do multiple other things to drive down, improve the points. You can go in as much detail as you want, right? But if you do the simple thing of writing down your common values in detail, getting a sign-off from everybody, including all the current people working in the company, don't shove these values down their throat, and then follow them every day. What it means is that if there's a star salesperson who doesn't get along with other team members, who tramps on the feet of others, and who's just a nuisance to everybody, he will not get a promotion no matter what. If it doesn't align with culture, over time they will go. Companies or young entrepreneurs especially find this difficult to do. The person is bringing $1 million in revenue or 5 crores in revenue. How can I let him go? But I'm saying the person is also poisoning the pool. So you need to find a solution. You need to live by the values that you have told folks. And you can update your values, you know, over 2, 3, 4, 5 years, revisit them as you grow mature, the organization grows mature. But write down these values. The other smart thing you can do is to have a physical manifestation of the value. We had a culture certificate, and we also had, you know, a silver coin that we gave to everybody. Yeah, we had that silver coin that we gave to everybody. It says, you know, I impact the career. I impact career of students. You know, once you give it to somebody and they have there in their wallet all the time, they show it to clients, they feel it. They show it to their parents, they feel it. This is a physical manifestation, you know. You know, it can be done without it, but with physical manifestation, it becomes easier.
Right. That's a great point you bring up about trade-offs, right? Because, I mean, if you were to ask people to list down their values, I'm sure they'll pick, quality, integrity or whatever, right? But what is the cost that you're going to drive that quality at or integrity at, right? So it's like you mentioned, would you fire that salesperson for being unethical, for example, right? So does your integrity stand that test? So that's pretty important. And another significant part of your journey with CoCubes was that entire pivot that you guys did, right? When you had to downsize by almost 50%. Yeah. And then, it was a rebirth for you in many different ways. Again, this is something very unintuitive for people. I mean, I haven't seen too many founders and startups do a pivot really well. What would you advise? When do you pivot, and what are some things to keep in mind as you pivot?
Yeah, when do you pivot is a hard question. You should pivot as early as possible, with as much cash as possible, because what generally happens is entrepreneurs wants to make things work, right? But most ideas which work are not complex ideas. They are simple ideas. Facebook is a simple idea to start off. Instagram is a simple idea to start off. Even something like Ola is a simple idea to start off. Simple, I mean that you can do quick delivery of your promise. These are ideas which really scale. Most of us think of complex ideas. This will happen, and this will happen, and this will happen, and this will happen. Then the customer will be happy. And then when this will happen 1,000 times, then I'll make a lot of money, right? And you take it upon your ego to say, I will solve this hard problem, no matter what. Mm-hmm. And you take a lot of time to realize that I need to simplify the idea. Either I need to focus on a smaller need, or I need to change my customer segment, or I need to change my market, or I need to change my product. You start building everything that a customer asks for, and you realize that one shouldn't build everything that a customer asks for, because they're actually not giving you, they're just giving you solutions. They're not telling you your problem. You need to understand the problem and not build the solution. There's so many different nuggets there. But fundamentally, entrepreneur starts taking it on as ego, saying, I will solve this. And you go too far down to be able to pivot. So if you can realize these signs early, that this will not be a large company, there is not going to be a product market fit, or whatever you want to set out to do, the sooner you can pivot. So, step away. Don't take it on your ego. Be willing to change and do it as early as you can.
Right. Yeah. Again, one more thing that you mentioned is super interesting there, which is that listening to a customer's problems, trying to understand the customer's problems and not really going by their recommended solutions, right? Which is because oftentimes when a customer comes to you with a problem, they literally say, hey, can you do this for us? But it's important to understand why they're asking you that, what is the problem they're facing. And, you could probably solve this in a better, cheaper, faster, better way. If you think about the problem and not just think that, you have to execute that solution, right?
I think this is super critical in the sense of, I'll give you an example. At CoCubes, we were an assessment company finally. Mm-hmm. And, in our assessments, all questions used to be loaded at the same time on the same page. So we started getting a lot of pushback from our sales guys and ops guys saying, the client is saying they only want to see one question per page. Mm-hmm. All our competitors used to follow that. And the client bol raha hai ki jab tak wo nahi hoga, main nahi kharidunga. I will not buy till you have one question on one page. This went on for a long, long time. And Vibhor, being the product head, the CTO, the co-founder, he said, we don't need to do that. And finally, when we got, sales guy said, iske bina we can't sell. Then we actually ended up talking to the customer and said, why are you asking for this? And they said, we are asking for this because a lot of students give tests together. We don't want cheating to happen. Okay. And we said, but if a test is 30 questions, we are actually picking 30 questions from 10,000 questions. So no students sitting next to each other have the same questions actually. And after that, the sales started happening because the customer's point was not, I want one question per page. His point was, I don't want cheating to happen. Right. To me, this demonstrates, everything that we do wrong when we start building what the customer asks for.
Right. So your book begins with a regret, right? Where you say that, we weren't able to solve this problem. And you are deeply passionate about people, about education, about careers and so on, right? So seeing as it is right now, how EdTech has completely transformed, you know, probably the hottest sectors at this point of time, you know, what are your thoughts about how EdTech itself has evolved in this time?
There are no thoughts per se. You know, I think everybody knows where EdTech is heading now.
Right.
I generally think that we missed the bus. I definitely missed the bus, right? With how soon it has come online. And, you know, there is an example in the book where I, it's a real thing that happened, that when we started CoCubes, I went to the founder of an assessment company, which was very big, and said, we want to do online assessments. And they were an offline assessment company. It was not Elliott Musk, by the way. The guy said, yaar, college mein toh computer hi nahi hai, tum online kaise karoge? And I said, what is he talking about? I went to the colleges and they have 500 computer labs. But that guy had started 10 years ago and he had stopped going to the market. Right. Similarly, you know, when the EdTech boom happened, I missed the EdTech boom. You know, I said, yaar, bachche aise seekh hi nahi sakte. If somebody is going to prepare for JEE, which is once in a lifetime exam, they're not going to learn online. You know, they're going to go to a physical place. Even if the father has to rent their, you know, rent their entire property, or, you know, what do you call, put it on something, the student will go and prepare physically from for JEE. Why will they do it online? But, you know, Vedantu, Topper, Byju's, they have proved in our academy, everything has proved it wrong, because it seems like the market is so much deeper. There are so many people who don't have the money to do it. And, you know, now online is available everywhere. So, you know, I'm saying I completely missed the bus. But hopefully I'll not miss the bus in what is going to come in the next 4 or 5 years.
Right.
And I think a lot of change is going to happen. I think a lot of because the fundamental change that is happening now is teachers are now comfortable with online.
Correct.
You know, I was talking to a relative today who's a teacher, and, you know, she never used to use a mobile or a laptop or anything. And she teaches 3rd, 4th, 5th grade. And she's now absolutely comfortable doing it. She actually said, hopefully school kabhi khule hi na. Because mujhe homework ki copyaan check karni nahi hai. I don't want to check homework at all.
Right.
So, you know, somebody who's building a homework app, like a company we invested in called Real Learning. I'm saying, I think there is huge opportunity.
I
think the next set of opportunity will come from the change in teachers, because the first change of demand has already happened.
Right. And also, I mean, the huge changes in terms of mobile penetration, internet, obviously, and so on and so forth, right? Obviously. I mean, it's been a key enabler. So Harpreet, we've spoken enough about, like, you know, last 10 years, what has happened. But these days, when you listen to some of these startups pitch you, right? What are some things that they're doing fantastically well?
I think many founders today have already worked in startups. And I think that is great. You know, they have worked in Ola, they've worked in Flipkart, you know, they've worked somewhere else. They have seen some amount of scale. You know, they have done that jugaad bazi, right? And I think that is amazing. They know what they're getting into. I think the environment is more supportive. You know, we hear less of saying, mere parents mere ko mana kar rahe hain. You know, so I think those are two things that have done fantastic. The third thing also is that the quality of programmers has improved. Product thinking has improved in the country, right? It wasn't there 10 years ago. There were very few people who were thinking product, who were thinking scale. Now you can find a lot of people who want to do that. And obviously, there are not enough CTOs, there are not enough tech people to go around. But it has definitely improved. But, you know, building a company is still hard. There are so many mistakes you can still make.
Right.
Because you're doing learning for the first time. But I think everybody goes through the same thing over and over again. But I think the quality of entrepreneurs is much, much higher than we were seeing before. So the competition is much higher. I think the information asymmetry is much lesser. There's a new hot sector. Everybody's jumping into it. For example, you want to look at online coding. There are 100 startups doing online coding, right? The one thing that founders miss is, if you want to become big in a hot sector, then you need to lock up the investors earlier. You know, for example, there are good startups, good entrepreneurs building an online coding company right now. But if you're only building an online coding company as of today, you're going to have a hard job doing it, because all top investors have already taken their picks. So how will you raise capital to be able to build your company? Unless you have a serious differentiator. For example, you know, Byju's was the first one. Byju's built a sales organization. and said, I'm going to sell the hell out of, you know, education. Mm-hmm. But Khan Academy came. So for Baiju's, distribution was through sales. Mm-hmm. And everybody else after that who adopted the Baiju's model struggled to raise capital. But Khan Academy was able to raise capital because they have a different model. Their distribution is YouTube. Their distribution is teachers. So you need to have a differentiation to be able to do that. Mm-hmm. It is something that a lot of founders miss even today.
Right. So, Harpreet, this has been a fascinating conversation. We've spoken about various facets of business building, about the book. My final question to you is, you know, what do you hope that the book will achieve in the future?
Yeah, I'm saying the book can achieve whatever, you know, they can do some numbers, right? But I hope that everybody who wants to work in a startup, you know, thinks about building a company, you know, can get a chance to read it and know that they can build a company, that it is possible for them to build a company. And if they want to work hard enough, long enough, smart enough, you know, this is how the journey will possibly look. Sometimes you can get really lucky. I know of a founder who started a company and in 3 months, another company bought it off for $10 million. So you can get lucky. And it was a cash deal, yeah, in India. So you can get lucky, but most times people don't get lucky. Yeah. So this is how the journey will be like. And you know, before you take a step in that journey, you know, you can take a look of what it will feel like and hopefully take a look and then make a choice to actually go ahead and do it.
Right. All right, Harpreet, this has been a fantastic conversation. Thank you so much for your time and all the best for all of your future projects and initiatives.
Thank you, man. And, you know, thank you for hosting me. And, you know, all the best to everybody who's listening to this. And hope you guys build a fantastic company and do well in whatever you want to do.
Folks, just an update on Startup Operators Jobs in Focus. A 314 Capital portfolio company, Niveshi, is looking to hire a senior ML researcher. Niveshi is an AI-powered investment fund. Now that sounds cool. What they're doing is putting AI and automation at the heart of the architecture, and they're reimagining systematic investment strategies. So as an ML researcher, you'll get to lead the research effort and improve Niveshi's AI engine, and you'll get to develop AI-generated trading strategies for new markets and things to that effect. Sounds super cool, super interesting. And if you know someone who gets their kicks out of this stuff, then do let them know about this. I'll share the job details and so on in the episode description for your reference. Thank you so much for listening. If you liked this episode, then don't forget to subscribe to us on your favorite platform and share this episode with all of your fellow startup operators. Also, follow the Startup Operator on LinkedIn and Twitter for more updates. Stay safe, take care, and see you soon on a brand new episode of the Startup Operator.